All right, I'm going to switch out programs here. Try to hook up my phone to it. Should work.
Gary.
Let's see. All right. Can you hear me now?
Yep.
All right. My name is Dennis Clayton. I have been in the photography industry since I was in ninth grade, where I started my first business photographing all the sporting events and selling pictures to the cheerleaders and the Giants. It kept me in ice cream and buying all the chemicals that I needed for my darkroom. It was actually my dad's darkroom. He was a military photographer, and so I grew up around photography. Did photography throughout high school, and after high school, worked 1 year in a department store and decided that wasn't for me, and decided that I would open up a business, or I had to do wedding photography for a couple years at that point. But I ended up working part-time for my father at a small camera store. And out of the back end of his business, I took and started my photography business. Because, you know, every proud father's going to go, oh, he can do that. And there was a lot of jobs that I had no idea how I could do. But when you're starting, you sit there and you go, yeah, I'll give it a try. So I made my career for 35 years full-time of being a photographer. Only got out of it because of disability. And of course, in 2008 was that time period. And the economy collapsed, and nobody wanted to spend what I was charging for doing high school senior portraits anymore. So I decided in 2015 to retire from working, and I started as a way of lowering stress from running my own business to get into a little bit of woodworking. If you saw the slideshow I was running ahead of time, see, I started out doing flat decorative boxes, and the joints had to be perfect, because that's that stupid perfectionist mind of mine, trying to make everything as good a quality as I might have the skill to do. Saw woodworking at a show, and bought a lathe, and, well, you know, everybody in this room knows how addictive the lathe is. And I'm on my third lathe, which is a robust Sweet 16. And it's a beautiful lathe that you never had a chance to work on. So that's a little bit of a backstory of what I do here. And my work is I like love the term, but at a certain point in my life, plain wood got to be so boring for me that I decided that I was going to start to do a little bit of embellishment. 1 year when I was down at the art show that's down in Chicago.
The sofa show?
Yeah, it was at the sofa show. I saw Molly Whitten down there at a table doing embellishment. And while I had this wood burning pin that was only powerful, a cub wood burner or something like that, it's good enough to actually sign your name with. That's all the power it had. Well, it wouldn't do the things that she was doing. And then I couldn't use my hand for a long time, and ended up just basically helping out the club for 5 years before I could work with my hands. I got muscle damage here. And then I bought a Burnmaster, and now I do carving with rotary tools. I carve with hand tools, and I also what I call hot knife carving, where I'm working with a cherry red tip on there and carve away. the piece up there with the keyhole in there. That came to me in a dream, and it is 100% carved with a hot knife. I spent a month working on this piece. It's only that tall. It's not a big piece, though. So, it worked out to be a very nice piece. And so this kind of gives you a little bit of backstory of, I love art, and I love to be able to see shape and form. And that all relates to what I'm going to talk about tonight, is how to create that shape and form of your wood charts that you're trying to photograph. This is my current studio that's in my basement. After I moved out of the commercial space that I was in for 29 years, I ended up having to take out a perfectly good wall and carpeting in the basement that this area was never used once I built it out. And so now I've got the full length of the house to use as a camera. On one end, I have a vertical copy stand that I can take pictures of a flat disc or whatever it might be. I'm doing a lot of PDFs for educational things, so if there's a tool that I can't find a good picture on the internet for, I walk downstairs and grab that tool and put it on there, and then I've got my photos to work with. I photographed all sorts of people down here, business people, girl that became Miss America was in my basement being photographed, did Miss Madison, Miss Wisconsin for several years. So there's a lot of different things that can happen in a small space. It's only 12 foot wide, 8 foot ceilings, and 26 feet long. I can't remember the exact distance, but it gives me a lot of space to work with. And you can see in the photo that there is all kinds of equipment down at that end. But you don't need all that type of equipment. That's what I'm going to kind of show you tonight. The first thing that you need is a good camera. This is not a good camera. It'll take nice snapshots of scenery, but photographing your woodworking, and I'll show you later on in the picture why I don't like it. But it is good for recording images, but if you want to create an art photograph of an artwork that you spent a lot of time on, it's not the thing to do. This little point and shoot that I'll use for being able to broadcast stuff here does a great job. And my professional level camera that I have, I can buy a ton of these for the price. It will do a lot more things. So the more you spend on equipment, the better the quality, the outcome you're going to have. But you also have to have the knowledge of how to use the tool. So at Badger Woodturns, I've had for years people saying, can you do a program for us, but dummy it down so we can use our cell phones? And I'm going, no, I won't do that. I'll dummy it down so you can use a $650 point shoot camera and take nice pictures. But this is not the answer. In the studio, there are big strobe lights and big light sources that I use to photograph. And tonight we're going to just get it as simple as we can. So the camera's a tool. When you look at these two photographs here, and you have to wonder, is that a cell phone photograph or is that a professional level camera or a point and shoot camera? Well, when I was out in Santa Barbara visiting friends, I had all my pro equipment, but the docks was all fogged in. Barely see a lot of area in there. And I, one angle, you can see where there's a seagull on top of that pillar there. You can see there's a little fog, and you start looking at the sailboats in there. And so that's looking this way, and I turned right, and I can see this little dinghy going out. And I walked to the end of the dock, pointed my point and shoot camera, and took a picture. Now, there's a ton of Photoshop work on that picture. But it's a 20-inch picture that hangs on my wall. The one of the seagull is a 14-inch tall picture that hangs on the staircase going down to the studio, along with other professional work that I've done. So it's just a tool. I know people who put 16 by 20s up from the iPhone photographs. The newer ones have that capability of doing. So a tool for every situation. You can go out and buy yourself a Harbor Freight lathe, and you can turn a roll with it. Might not be very fun, but you can turn a roll with it. you can have a jet nidiolite and have much more proficient time to turn a hole with that. Or you can go out and buy yourself a robust American Beauty and go, man, that thing is smooth. So everything's a tool, whether you use a sorbet tool or whatever tools that you use. If you get the job done, you're satisfied with it. That's all that matters. Number one rule for taking and getting good quality photographs is cleaning your lens. When was the last time you cleaned the lens on that video?
Never.
That means that I'll be nice and fuzzy. You have to keep lenses clean. Just like on the back of your camera, I see so many people taking pictures with their cell phones, and you can see an inch of dirt on top of it. It's designed to do that. Just use a soft cloth, do that, and clean the stuff that's in your pocket lens off of it so you get a much clearer picture. I see a lot of pictures on the internet that are so fogged over, it looks like they're in that foggy scene that I was at down at the top. It wasn't a foggy scene. So clean lens will start off by getting your best photograph that you're going to get. Now we have to go back in history. I was a film photographer. I went digital in my studio in 2002. But I started studying Photoshop about 1995. That's when I first got it for scanning images for marketing my studio. And so when I went digital, I had a pretty good grasp on how to work it. And Kodak, one year, they came to the convention and said, buy 1 year's worth of film for your studio. We'll give you this 1 megapixel Kodak digital camera. So you can start learning digital photography because it's in your future. I go, not my future. I'm going to retire before they go to digital. Yeah, it didn't happen. The two pictures on here, I have no metadata to be for sure. I think the one on the left was actually a picture from the film that I had a local camera store scan it, and it's just a horrible quality picture, taken on top of a speaker in my house. It was strictly to have an image to put into my journal, what I gave to somebody for Christmas or whatever. And that's how I started photographing my woodchart. I just wanted a record of life. What I gave to this person, what I gave to this person, to that person, because they didn't want to give them the same thing next year for Christmas. And I had all kinds of friends that were getting woodcharts, just like I'm sure everybody out here gives away stuff as gifts. And pretty soon they go, whoa, I got enough stuff. Too many trinkets. The one on the right, I think, is the small digital camera. It's grainy as can be when you actually look at the photograph. It's got a lot of texture to it. So one of the things that you want to be thinking about when you're photographing is besides the quality of the camera that you're working with, is if you look at that box of blue background and you look at the shadow side of it, you're going to see an awful lot of blue reflecting into that. So don't do as I did when I first started out. I had blue paper from the studio, grabbed a piece, took it home, set it up, and took a picture with a point-and-shoot camera. And boy, that just doesn't look good. So I re-photograph a lot of stuff for purposes like this for education. Let's say I have a digital journal of a lot of different photographs. It's well over 100 pages of different images. And it tells what size and materials and stuff. When you're doing layouts, in today's world, I use a piece of acrylic as my base. So I get a reflection off of it, mirror image, but a ghostly image. So I have a hint of the base. And when you see that same hole taken back in the day when I actually cut it out for the purpose of making little parts out of it, it just doesn't look good without some type of a shadow hold it to the earth. So shadows can play a good place in your images. And again, grainy picture with that blue background, and it just doesn't look as crisp and clear as having a nice neutral background to it. So now all of a sudden, in this history of my endeavor to photograph my wood turnings, A friend bought the Olympus camera, E10. Cost $2,000 back in that time period for that, 2001. In that time period, and it had a big, huge chip in it. It was 6 megapixels or 8 megapixels, somewhere around in that area. The lens quality is super sharp. It actually had more depth of field than the full frame cameras that I use today. But I got detail on it. But I just can't blow it up to wall size if I wanted to, because it's just too small of a file. The cameras just keep progressing and progressing. Now, you've been seeing some different backgrounds and stuff. The most important thing is selecting a background is for your wood turnings, is to have something neutral. You can have a white background, black background, a gray background, but something neutral so it's not going to reflect that color into the species of wood that you spend all that time getting a beautiful piece of floral walnut and all of a sudden destroying because you've got a purple background and having that reflect into your floral walnut. Wouldn't look very good at all. So I found that through photographing for a friend of mine that sells his work. That when he goes to certain galleries, they want a professional image done on a gray background. My own personal stuff, I photograph everything in a white background. That's for me, for my journal. But a gray background is a nice all-around thing. When you look at Instagram and Facebook and all these other sites, you can see a lot of professional artists are photographing on a gray background. Because it's going to help set things up and it fits within the gallery, the online gallery, so that everything looks kind of like they photographed it by a lot of different photographers, be it professional or amateur. And the whole point is to get you to a point where you get something that looks professional without maybe spending thousands of dollars to photograph something and sell for $100. Also, you know, in a camera like this, I'm setting this camera up completely auto exposure to work with. In my studio, everything is done with electronic flash, everything's done manual. It's a whole setup of different ways. But in the quick and easy, simple way of doing things, with a gray background, you're going to have a better chance of getting auto exposure that turns out correctly for you. So here's showing you exactly how I set up my journal. It's well over 100 pages I mentioned earlier, and I can have 3 images on it. I can have 6 images. I've got dates, I've got sizes, the type of wood, because I got gray hair, you know? I forget a lot of details, and I certainly can't tell you what some of this wood that I used 18 years ago, 20 years ago. So this for me is a nice way of having a little bit of records. Now, when you look at these two squares, these gray squares, it's obvious that one is lighter than the other. That's because the brain fools you. Because if you've got a black background, it's going to make it look a lot lighter. If you have a white background, it's going to make it look a lot darker. And so when we bring these together, they're the same 50% gray. This is all set up in Photoshop. So I know it's complete. All you do is slide the wedges together so that it works out. So lighting is the most important thing. We're not going to be talking about specific cameras or any of the setups in that because we could spend 4 years trying to teach you how to use your particular camera. And nobody wants to know about how do you set them and ultimately make a Nikon or whatever it happens to be. So lighting is what I want to deal with in the PowerPoint, and then I'll show you when it's set up. So one thing that I learned a long, long time ago in the portrait industry is that there is one sun in the sky and one shadow on Earth. At the moment we take this light, like it's set up in a lot of TV setups, all of a sudden you see a shadow this way and you see a shadow this way here. It's not natural. So the sun is up high, the shadow should come down low, and it should be only one shadow. But that's also hard when you're trying to set up the photograph of, gosh, that's such a harsh look. So I use reflectors and stuff. When you look at this image here, you can definitely see that the light that's up high is casting a shadow down. So that's overpowered. And that you've got a shadow coming from the camera, right, I'll call it, and going towards the left side. And so all that stuff is playing, all this breakfast in your brain. And it's just not a comfortable thing for a viewer to want to look at for a long period of time. In portrait photography, we talk about highlights and shadows. Highlight, shadow, highlight, shadow, highlight, shadow. And having all these highlights and shadows will give you the curvature of the face and give you dimensionality to it. Same thing's true with our wood turns. If you look at a painting or a drawing, these are images I found painting and drawings from the internet, but you're going to see that they purposely put in dark areas because dark recedes and the light colors come forward on there. And that's what shows you the curvature of the ground or whatever it is that they're drawing. So here's a piece that I did for my friend Dave Turner. He's an accomplished artist that sells lots of work in this category. And what we're trying to do is to get a nice gradation to the background. So it's not too bright, too dark. You want to have some highlights. You want to have brighter on one side than the other, but you don't want a harsh contrast on it. So here's a photo shoot that we're going to do. In my studio with my equipment through these photographs. And by the way, this PowerPoint will be made into a PDF, and I'll be sharing that with your folks. I'll be sending that out tomorrow so that I can go on the website so you can download it. This little box is set up on a gray background. You can see that the big light source to the left, it is a 3.5 by 5.5 foot softbox with electronic flash behind it. Now, in professional studio lights where we're using electronic flashes, also another light bulb in there that's on all the time called the modeling light. So I can see where the shadows are going, and then the flash is so powerful that it overrides that. And the shutter speed is up high enough and a small enough f-stop to get way too technical, and that light source doesn't mean anything at all. It's not affecting the exposure at all.
Quick question. The camera you use, can you talk about that? It looks obviously professional, but I mean that lens alone.
That is a Canon 5D Mark IV. And it is a 70 to 200 millimeter lens on there with an extension tube to allow me to focus in closer. And that has been replaced now, within a couple weeks ago, to Canon R5 with 70 to 200 millimeter lens. And that lens was sharp. This new one is even sharper on there. So I photograph at 200 millimeters. It gives me the perspective that I'm looking for. Longer lenses are going to compress your scene a little bit. But the downside is there's no depth of field, millimeter. We'll talk about that portion a little bit.
Does it matter what color light you're using? I mean, when you're trying to get the warmth out of a piece of wood or whatever the case is, 3,000 is going to be warmer than a 4,000.
Well, if you use auto white balance on your camera, that doesn't mean anything. That it's going to adjust and bring you back to daylight. That's a Photoshop thing for you to change that a little bit in Photoshop to change your color balance. This demonstration light that I have, it's just an LED 200 watt LED bulb at 5500 Kelvin temperature. And the camera that I'm setting up here, it's just an auto white balance, the gray background. There's a white tube here to easily see highlights and shadows. So it makes, if you have a 3000, a 3200 tungsten bulb, and you set the camera to 3200, it's the same thing as using daylight. So, in film world, it made a lot more difference. A lot of us are equipment, these iPhones are all auto white balance in that situation. Did that answer your question?
Yes. Okay.
On the PDF, you'll see at the top of the background there, there is a superior background. It's a 50, number 58, the gray. There are so many gray background papers that you can get. And some of them are warm side, some of them are on the cold side, they're either blue or yellow, and this is the most neutral. Even though coming out of the box, it has a little tinge of magenta to it. The more it's opened up, sitting in the room, that magenta fades out. I just bought a new roll, and I think I looked at three rolls before I settled on one. Because I used to have a color lab, and I used to print all the time. All those little details get the color just right. Fortunately, my color won't. Or maybe I'm unfortunate because it's way too thick to go outside. So that was with one light. Now we want to create some form. And this is the whole point of the program tonight, is to how to show you with one light how you can create some form with it. I will be talking about using a top light at a low level, but that's not really easy for most people to set up a top light to work with. So in this photograph, you're going to see that on the table, there is a black card and there are two white cards. And the black card is reflecting in the edge of the shiny box at the very back edge. You're going to see that there is a little bit darker edge on there. And if we did not have the black card there, it would be the same tonality as the rest of the side. Maybe it'll fade into the background too much. So we're using these cards to create the form, to give us a dark edge, to give us a highlight in the shadow. And then there's a transition between the left side of the box that is lit by the big soft box, and the reflector cards. There's a little area right in there, it's a little bit darker in tone, and that helps to build the roundness in there. So in this photograph, I'm adding a light source to the top that's set at about half power to less than what the big light is on the side. And what it's doing is going to lessen the intensity of the shadow created by the big light source on the left. But it's also causing some flare, or some glare off the shiny surface of the box, because it's got a coating Krylon gloss on that box. So it's going to glare quite a bit. And so the next thing that we're going to do is I'm going to bring in a flag, a scrim, whatever you like to call it. I have another heavy light stand that's got a sandbag on it, and then there's an arm that goes across that holds a long piece of black foam board on there. And I bring that down, up and down, to reflect black into the top. So I need that light source, especially on a bowl, to be able to illuminate the inside of the bowl area. Otherwise, it's going to be a dark void in there. So that's where that top light helps. So you can just see that it has more detail now into the lid in there. The stainless steel canister really helps you see this whole thing. You can see I have actually taken and brought in on the floor, but on the tabletop, I have brought in some black boards just out of camera view. You have to realize with the way that I use my photography with a white background, I go and later on and I totally take out that white background, because photographing white, no matter what you do, it's pretty much going to have some pixels in there, which means you're going to have some areas that are going to be gray. So I cut out that whole canister except for the bottom, because I wanted that little bit of that reflection in there to nail it to the tabletop. And so I bring my whiteboards as close as I can to bring in a black edge in there. I have cards that are behind, and that scrim comes down from the top, and it's reflecting black into the lid there. So there's lots of cards going in. You can see all kinds of lines and stuff that are in that particular image there. So if you don't have that many white cards, well, you can just use one white card and a black card, and you'll still get a look of stainless steel in there. If you can photograph a stainless steel canister, you can photograph wood turnings. Years ago when I studied commercial photography, there was an old guy that was teaching how to photograph, I think, glass bottles and stuff. And all of it, these cards that he was using to do all this stuff was like stuck in the corner of the mind. And then when I started photographing my work, it's like, do I really remember? And there wasn't a lot of YouTube videos available when I first started doing this stuff. Got a few things, a lot of YouTube videos now. Well, yeah. But just bringing in these little cards will help to bring stuff. This is a photograph of a piece of stainless steel dairy equipment, piece that I did for a company out of Wanakee. This was taken anywhere between 75 and 79. This is with film, where I probably only took 3 pictures of it, just to have a bracket of exposures. And I do remember laying out all kinds of black and white cards going around. And one of the things I learned from that old guy from that one convention was that Hubbard deodorant was your friend. So when you look at the bottom edge on the right, you see a little white line that's in there. It's the flaw that's in there because I didn't clean that properly because I can see remnants of some powder in there. It's unretouched. All I did is go and go to my print portfolio of stuff I did in years ago and scanned it for program like this. But you can see it looks like stainless steel. There are dark areas, there are light areas. You need that to show the core. So here's what we're going to do tonight. The monitors don't show off what you can see on the laptop there, but the PDF will show you. You can actually see both edges of the tube on there. And we're just bringing in cards to take and build some contrast into there. You can add in a little bit of a white edge in there to soften up that shadow on there. And for going home and trying to figure out how to make this stuff work for you, just go out and find yourself a piece of PVC pipe, sand up all the print on it, take a Scotch-Brite and buff it up so it's nice and matted on there, and use that as a way of playing around with light to see how you can move your light. Do I need to bring this light up high? Do I need it low? Do I need it forward? Do I need it backwards? But this is our cheap softbox. You know, my softbox would probably run today about $500 just for the light modifier. That's $8 worth of ripstop nylon from Joann's or any of those places that sell it. There's nothing special about it, just white. You have to look at it and make sure it's not yellow or a warm one, just as light as you can find. Now here's another project of taking some acrylic paint, white, and putting it on my white acrylic surface that I use. I could not find opaque whites for this plastic. It's a good 1/4 inch thick. So it's translucent, but not opaque. So I run my white background underneath of that. Otherwise I'd be seeing through to the tabletop that's underneath of it. Just one of those resin tables that you get cheap at the stores. And so the second shot at the top layer is just bringing in some black at the bottom to help building some contrast and then bringing in the boards all the way around so that the reflection of black going all the way around. And then after it's cut out and left in just a little bit of the tabletop reflection in there, you're able to see a nice black line all the way around that white. Photographing white on white is the hardest thing to do. So that's just a good thing to be thinking about. Camera angle is another thing that you want to be thinking about. If you can get your camera parallel to what you're photographing, you're going to get your better perspective out of it. if you take a photograph high, the monitor just doesn't show it as well. But if you think of looking down the railroad tracks, the lines all converge on you. And that's the same thing as if you take the high camera angle, by the time you get to the bottom, you already have distorted your image. So try to be just a little bit above the height of your project that you're photographing, and that way you will have a better perspective on things. I've having some difficulties in muscles in that. I have an old studio posing chair that goes up and down, up and down. I'm sitting behind a tripod in my basement, and I'm bent all over this. My tabletop is only this high, and I should have a tabletop this high. It make my back a lot happier. So with that, I'm still trying to get down as low as possible, looking at the piece I'm photographing so that I get the best perspective. And there's where my 200 millimeter lens works a little bit better. Now, 200 millimeter lens on a full frame camera, that's the key, is that if you're using a crop sensor, a digital SLR, or a 1-inch sensor like we have in this particular camera, 100 millimeters is different on all of it. So this goes up to 100 millimeters equivalent, the way that your eye sees when you compare it to what you're seeing with a full frame camera. So the human eye is 50 millimeters in strength, or very close to that. So if you go 100 millimeters, it's a 2x lens on there, and 200 millimeter 4x lens. So I get to work a little bit further distance, but it has those drawbacks of very little depth of field to work with. This is the one thing that I hate the most. Little photo boxes. It's a lot of floating around our club. You have no room to put cards and reflectors and stuff. Your light is nailed in there in one position. You have no place to do it. I built my first one in 1973 when I was taking jury design in high school. And you're photographing silver pieces that people are making in their jewelry. Light boxes are phenomenal for something like that because you got light coming from all around and you're seeing metal on there. But with wood turning, and I think they're also great for what they're really put on this earth to do in today's world is going to sell something on Craigslist or Etsy or whatever, and you just need something to put up on there. You're not looking for something artistic out of it. That's the place for this. But that's my opinion. Now, I have a full photography studio, and our past president, he is a good photographer. He takes great pictures of his work. As you can see, a little bit with this ornament that he carved. He has highlights, he has shadows. His light source is a speed light, but it has no modeling light. So it has no light, you have no idea where that light's gonna fall on the subject. So he's just setting it up and I'll take a picture and then I have a look at the back of the sensor on the back of the camera to see what did this camera take? Because you can't visualize that the highlights and shadows ahead of time. So I have this little hood loop that it goes on the back of the sensor to be able to turn off all the light around to be able to see that, to see the viewfinder on the back so I know what's happening. That's where the hood is there. He uses a flash and then he has some light that's coming in through the window on the left side of the frame. So that's where he's getting his fill from, or how I use cards to work with. And this worked out great for him. He has a website, he sells all kinds of Santa related items, and he'll be at our fall show selling a bunch of them.
You mentioned something about an artistic photo versus something you're going to sell something with. I just wonder if you could elaborate on that. I mean, is there a difference between an
artistic.
I think when you're going to try to create highlights and shadows and show roundness to that, you're being more artsy with the work that you're doing. If you just need a picture to post to sell, you don't have to worry about everything I'm talking about. But for me, when I'm photographing, I need to show off my artwork. I need to show all the carving detail that's in the pieces that I carved on. I want to show the brain structure in the pieces that I'm doing for my personal thought pattern. So I can't tell you as an artist what is the right way to use photography or great photography. It's the way that I think. So I might be using the word the artistic photography, so much, but to me, it's still some of the relevance. That answer?
I'm just kind of wondering. I mean, I think from what I'm getting from the artistic photos, looking for a lot of contrast. And I'm thinking of somebody trying to buy something online, they want to see all the detail. Maybe there's a difference between those two approaches.
Well, there's a sweet spot between contrast and showing roundness. If you only use one light and don't use those reflectors like I was showing, you are going to just have contrast, but then the shadows are going to be blocked up, you're not going to see detail. So it's a hard one to get the brain around, and I can't help you out on that. We talked about that. These three photographs are all taken one after another. My iPhone, my point and shoot, and my professional camera on the right. All taken, as you can see, very close to the same height, except for the one on the right, just a hair taller, a little higher, as you can see over the lip of the vessel. Notice how skinny the base is on the one on the left, the iPhone. That's distortion. The lens on here is equivalent, if you think of the 35 millimeter full frame or the old days of film, that's what we call that size of that negative slice, full frame. And if you think of that world, this is a 28 millimeter lens. And 28 millimeter lenses all distort in a circular pattern on there. And what it's done at the edges is it's circled in and pushed all everything together on there. That's why it looks so skinny on there. This camera has it has zoom lens on it, and zoomed out, it's equivalent to 100 millimeter, twice as powerful as the eyeball. And perspective of that 100 millimeter versus the professional camera with 200 millimeter, so close, I'm not gonna argue with you. So anything, I would say for wood churnings, when you compare a full frame camera, 100 millimeter is equivalent to almost everything that you're gonna do. It just works physically for my setup to work better with a 200 millimeter lens. So there's where I go on that side there. Your sensors, I keep talking about full frame cameras. The red line indicates the size in relation to everything. The frame of a 35 millimeter negative or slide, or in the professional cameras, full frame digital cameras. And then you get your ESP-C, which is considerably smaller. And then you get down to the blue line, which represents the 1-inch sensor that's here. And then you go down. And then you can't even see how small the sensor is that's in this camera. It's so small. So all these different things kind of make a difference on how your camera is going to see the photograph versus my camera might do. So another question that I get a lot, how do you get away from glare? Close your eyes. Don't get any glare. Well, you might get a little bit through your eyelids. Glare is just something that's going to happen. You got a light source, it's going to reflect. We did an experiment with Dave one day. He says, I'm just going to buff up. He puts layers and layers of light on the poly at this piece. His finish is just spectacular. Smooth as glass when it's finished with it. And of course, smooth as glass reflects a big light source on there. So he brought one in that was buffed up with a Scotch Brite, great Scotch Brite. That was waiting for the next coating of white on poly. And so we photographed it. There's no hot spot in it at all, like the photograph on the right. One on the left doesn't have that big square that represents where that big light source is. But the colors are so muted looking, it's just horrible looking at it. So it loses anything that's matte, that's not going to reflect a mirror image of it. This thing, if you took your mirror in your bedroom and you just took the scratch right over and scratched the heck out of it so it's matte, so it didn't reflect the light of something that's over there into it. Well, you wouldn't want to look at that anymore, say that, just ruin that. So the matte finish will get rid of the hot spot, but it's going to lose so much detail that's in that image. Some of his pieces I have taken and set up my light on one side. I photographed, made sure the camera didn't move, moved everything all the way around, photographed it again on the other side of Photoshop, married the two together so I could get rid of that hot spot. A lot of work, maybe by the hour to photograph. Well, that's one of the things we don't do anymore. It's just a lot of work to do that. So glare is just something that's going to happen. The larger the light source, the more it's going to disperse the light around. Even though that picture on the right has a smaller source, it's because of the curvature of the vessel and where that glare is going to happen. So the next part of, before we get done with the PowerPoint portion, is how I create a lot of depth of field with 200 millimeter lens that only has a depth of field of about 2-3 millimeters, something like that. I do a process called focus stacking, which means that I will set up the camera, I've got a rail on it, and I take one picture, and I lock it, I turn it on once or twice, and lock it down and take another picture at about every 1.5 millimeters down the line. And these, all the pieces here were probably had anywhere between 30 and 60 images done, photographing slice, just like getting into that big white tube a lot of this is done where they take slice. And then it's all married through a separate program, not Photoshop. I don't like Photoshop's version of it. Helicon Focus is what I use. And it is a great program. I can take 60 images, and on the 5D Mark IV, that is a 30 megapixel camera, it would take about 3 minutes to process all those images into one. Not use the new camera that has 45 megapixels. The camera to the stack on that big. Then a third with a flower, and that probably took about 3 minutes to process that. So I know once I do a big stack of wood turning, it's going to take a bit longer than I'm used to. But with that, I'm able to show detail on these bowls that are, you know, 4 inches wide. I'm able to have detail from the front to the back. But you better know Photoshop and all those type of programs to be able to accomplish all that. Photoshop has a stacking feature to it. The problem I've had with it is that front rim leaves a blurred edge on that transitions into the background that I get almost what appears to be a quarter of an inch out of focus rim along that front rim on the back side of it. So I don't see the detail on the inside of the bowl. As well, because it's just that little area of drift. And Helicon Focus handles that so much better. It's a program by itself, costs a little over $200 for the lifetime version that I have. So they're upgrading it all the time, just like most of it, the stuff out there. So this will show you the actual camera that I use, well, the camera that I just retired, because we just sold that to the guy with the bird photographs. We're going up the Crane Foundation on Wednesday to photograph cranes. So we'll use my old setup and I'll use my new setup. So there's a rail that you can see that's on top of the tripod that has a screw in it, on the backside, and that's what I use to move the camera forward, all those little steps on there. For this camera, in order to focus in close, I have to actually take the camera off the lens, and there's two extension tubes on the bottom left-hand side. And they go in between the camera body and the lens, and they allow me to get more macro on it. Now, this lens is probably 18 years old. The newer versions, the one that I just got, have more macro range to it. So hopefully I don't have to buy a third-party extension tube. This camera doesn't make it for me. I also use a electronic release when I'm working up in the studio. That's what the coils are there. The back of the camera is your key to success. This little window that's showing on here tells me everything about how I'm photographing. And the most important thing is this histogram that's on the back. You see, it looks like a bunch of mountain peaks. If the mountain hits one of the two sides, you either overexpose it or underexpose. If it's on the left-hand side of the frame, all those white peaks are packed up over there, you're going to have no shadow detail whatsoever. That means you're underexposed. If it's all the way to the right, you're going to have no highlight detail because you've overexposed. You need it to be right in the middle, as much spread out as you can do.
So you're going manual on. You're not using auto.
Not in my studio, no. This camera's, I've never used it.
I mean, like, when you're going up Thursday.
No, well, that's a different situation. That will be set up with auto exposure on there. Maybe auto light balance, I'm not quite sure. I mean, it's just depending on the conditions, I may set it to specific Kelvin temperature.
But in-house, it's all manual.
Everything's manual. Yep, with this professional camera, it's all manual. But even on this camera, I have a histogram. So even on auto, I can see the histogram and know exactly what I am getting as far as getting that spread out there. I also photograph everything as a raw file format. A raw file is an unprocessed image. Cell phone, point-and-shoot camera, professional camera. If you record it as a JPEG, that's allowing some device to make decisions for you. And that's not always a good thing. So as a raw file, it has all the information that is possible to get off of that sensor. When a camera processes it as a JPEG, the first thing they do is they compress the file. Everybody's eating gel. Now imagine putting a handful of gel in your hands. And you go, okay, it's wobbling around there, but it looks pretty good. That's a raw file. Now take a JPEG and start squeezing your hands. What happens? Well, there's dough on the floor. Now that's just a level 10 JPEG. Now I'm being stingy with my file card, and I want to get 10,000 photographs on that file. Let's squeeze it down as tight as we can, down to the level one. There's no information left. All you have is granular, nasty picture. If you do anything other than put them back the sensor, that's so small of quality, and that's about it. If you try to post it to the internet, and someone tries to roll it up, it's like, whoa, that's a pretty bad picture. So JPEGs are a curse, but they are great if you can get the proper exposure to start out with. You have to take into Photoshop or any other similar type of programs and try to adjust the exposure of a JPEG. You can save it again as a JPEG. Every time you resave a JPEG, it compresses it even further. So I work with nothing but RAW. This iPhone here, I transfer it over to the computer through the method of that I can do here, and I get a raw file on this. So I have a lot more data than if I just email that photograph to me, because then I'm going to get a JPEG. Yes?
Is there a way to set that on your iPhone? How do you set it so that it gives you a raw file on your phone?
when we take a break, I don't know if I can show you. I can't at the moment. I can't remember what it's called, but it works very, very quick. I know we got to take a break here, so we close that upstairs. So these are all images that are done with stacking focus on there. I do want to make two points. First one is that October 29th, the Capital Area Carvers and Badger Woodturners is having our fall show. We have a new location after we lost our old location during COVID. They're going to be at the Forest High School Sunday, October 29th, from 9 until 4. It's open, it's free admission, free parking. You can come and look at stuff. We'll have some demonstrations going on. We usually have about 100 tables of displays. Some of them are just displays, some of them are sales. So there's a lot of stuff like that that's available to look at. And the other announcement, I have a friend who is moving into a condo sometime later this summer, as soon as it's finished being built out. And his robust American beauty cannot move into the condo. So I will be, if you are on the Badger Woodturners mailing list, it will go out in a mailing that I will do with his name and contact information. I'm not at liberty to share his name at the moment because he's got to wait until July before I can do that. If you are interested in an American beauty, you can grab one of my cards up here and send me an email so that I can put in a list to contact you. Also, I have cards up here for the fall show to remind you. But it'll be on the PDF as well when you get that. That's what we got for the PowerPoint. So if you want to take a break, so.
I think that'd be good. Try to get going again about 8. That'd be 10 to 15 minutes.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks.